Hey out there, this is Thursday, December 12th, 2019, and it is just about 12 minutes past 9 in the morning here in Northern California, and I will get into several different things as usual. I like to say I get into psycho-spiritual matters involving a basic understanding of economic matters, which helps people to understand what I believe is fundamental in what's bugging us, because we all know from a very young age that life's tough. It's tough being human. We're very smart from a very young age. Children are very smart. And adults would serve themselves well. It would behoove them greatly to learn from children. And this is something that Jesus taught. Lest ye be like little children, in no way will we enter the kingdom of heaven. We've got to have that purity, that pure, innocent essence, something beautiful that's worth saving to be able to be found worthy to go to a better world. That's what I consider heaven, basically. I mean, you could talk about the stages of heaven, like the highest heaven and all this, and I do believe there is levels to heaven. Now, the destiny for humanity is to realize heaven on earth, basically, because Jesus talked about that the end of an age and the beginning of a new age, when his throne is established upon the earth, Christ's return and the holy angels come as the harvesters. These are the ones that mete out justice upon the earth. They separate the wicked from the righteous. It's all very logical and makes perfect sense. Anybody that's been a parent can understand that at some point, if you've got children that can't get along, and you've got one group of kids that are bullying the other group, it's untenable indefinitely. You can't tolerate it forever. Children understand this. Children want rules so that there's a common adherence. There's something cohesive about the rules that brings people together and unifies them and says, hey, it's a level playing field and we like things fair, because we understand, even little children understand, there's a lot of injustice, unfairness in the world. And they have questions from a very young age, which they should. We should all have a lot of questions. We should question our reality that's handed to us from birth. Simple as that. I mean, I know a lot of the stuff I get into, and I do want to make a statement about this, but it sounds radical to the ear that's been trained to accept the establishmentarian status quo. And from what I have researched, what I have observed, empirically speaking, over decades and decades of paying attention, is that this scene in no way makes sense. So this whole world establishment is basically built on sand and nonsense. It's got to come to an end. And that's a huge departure. So a lot of people have a hard time wrapping their minds around what a departure it is to talk about things like, for example, universal prosperity. You see, that is so far removed from our current reality. And I say we need to ask. I say it's fair that children want to know the answer to these questions. And if they've got an aware, knowledgeable, wise parent, they'll answer them prudently, as Jesus perhaps would, and educate the child. Hey, you know what? I mean, don't envy the rich. Don't covet what others have. You know, they've got their problem. They're just human. You know, what would a man give for his soul? I mean, you know, you talk about values with the child. And so I like to get into that kind of stuff, and I like to inject things like logic and reason. I like the stuff that I teach and preach to make sense, and the only way I can do that is with God guiding me, because I'm as flawed as the next guy. I really am. I mean, I can be very pathetic. I can be very pitiable and weak, and I don't like to admit that, but there's no sense in not admitting it when it's true. It's like a confession, and I'm not going to get into the details of my personal issues. It's not proper that any human ear should have to hear and bear that kind of stuff. I mean, we've all got stuff that's very personal to us, and we have to take it to someone, and that someone is our owner. And that, you know, this is so fundamental to understand about the relationship we're to have with the God Almighty, the creator of the universe and everything contained therein. I mean, we are rightfully the property of another. And in our right mind, we will see that as a good thing. When we're really clear thinking, when we have that wisdom, we'll see that it's good to have a conscience. And that I attribute, that I think that's akin to this fear of the Lord people talk about. And it's just this fear of the Lord is not afraid, like I'm afraid, oh God, I better not do wrong and all. No, it's a great reverence, profound respect for the owner that gave you existence, that put everything into existence. And, it's a beautiful thing that we're a part of this. We've got to understand things like, you know, death. We've got to understand it from God's point of view, that it's not true. It's a lie from the pit of hell. I mean, these bodies, yes, they must go, but they're no more than a vessel, a vehicle. I mean, sure, they serve us well. They're great. God knows we all love them, right? I mean, the senses and all this, the touch and taste and smell and sight and sound, it's awesome. So they're very well, you know, our essence, the invisible part of us, is very well integrated into this physical atomic reality. But we're born into these bodies of death. That's a very bad thing, right? I mean, who wants, once you've been given this great gift of life, who wants to be have to relinquish it? But we all know, scientifically speaking, it's not being morbid, it's just being matter of fact, we all have to give it up. But if we learn about how God's perspective is on this, and understand that he wants us to embrace that perspective, then it looks a lot different. And I don't like to be too cold and dry about these things, because I'm as scared of death as the next guy. Okay, I mean, sure, I could talk tough. I say, don't be a coward, and I'm not afraid to die. That, you know, if these evil people want to kill me for speaking truth to power, and I offend somebody too much, whatever reason somebody might have to want to do me in, I just can't shrink away from it. I'm trying to be a good human being, a good brother to humanity, a friend to humanity. By extension, I'm being a friend to my owner, God Almighty, who loves us so dearly. He wants us to understand his point of view on these very critical issues like death. Are there bigger deals than death? Okay, we could talk about all the problems in the world, all the organic suffering we all have to experience. Okay, the myriad of diseases and natural disasters and uncomfortable issues like the temperature swings. And there's just such a host of organic suffering out there. The insects that can kill us. I mean, it never ends, right, with the organic stuff. And ultimately death, that's it. This is the price we pay for sinning. See, the soul that sins will die. So the soul is often conflated with the body, but it's not exactly the same. I mean, yes, we're very well integrated. It is, you know, a big part of how we express ourselves. I mean, we can't just be invisible and muted and all that and then expect anybody to benefit from us. So we use it to benefit human beings and by extension God, and it's all kind of one and the same, part and parcel, God and humanity. We're appendages, we're expressions of God, and he loves us all dearly, and he wants us to be comforted and encouraged. I mean, and it's as easy as welcoming the Father into your life, the Mother. God is described as male and female right there in the book of Genesis, right? The first book in the Bible you can read about the nature of God. And it all makes perfect sense. I mean, why did God do it all? Well, something to do, isn't it? I mean, well, he's got the, who knows? I mean, we can't really, at this point in our evolution, understand every little thing. But again, about these highest heavens, and you know, there's these differences in, you know, how good it gets. And we are on the track as human beings, these little children of God, basically, to realize the highest heaven, to know what it's all about. But there's always going to be some mystery, it seems to me, because it's written in Scripture, who am I, God, who am I am? That is, I am that I am. its existence. Well, how do you, you know, put existence in a neat little box and on the shelf? You can't really do that. It's existence. It is what it is. God is, and that's it. I am, he said. So it's something to do. You've got to admit. I mean, why do we do the things we do? We say, well, we're like God, you know, created in his image and likeness, it's written. And so we are imaginative. We're inventive, innovative. It's very natural to us. It's very enjoyable. We like to use our imaginations, our power of thought. And this is part of growth and evolution. So in a lot of ways, we're like God. And he just wants us to know him, so that we can help people to know themselves. Because if you, he who is in you is stronger than he who is in the world. And if it's a good guy, if you lean toward the godly nature, that instinctual godly nature put in all of us, that spark of divinity we all have, you're on the right track to inherit a better world. You don't. It doesn't have to get any worse than this, because this world is run by demonic forces. That's it. All the mindless minions out there that go along with these, the money masters, these are the top rulers, these top controllers, okay, like the New World Order, Cabal, you get into all these types. They're running the show. So these are the kingpins. These are the master mafiosos, the grand puppeteers, whatever you want to call them. That these are the ones that are at the top of this pyramid of perverted power. It's a satanic type power, because these are people that are defiant to God. They don't have right values, bratty little children that need disciplining. They need parenting. They've got bad values. They're bad actors, and they create the policies we are forced to live under. And they do that because they have an advantage, which of course is not in the long run, in the scheme of things. Their eternal salvation is at risk. Where they're going from here, they're going to be found among the wicked if they don't repent. They're going to perish in hell. I mean, they have to, because God, like any good parent, separates the children when they can't get along. He can't tolerate the righteous being bullied forever, and that's what's going on here. They rule over the righteous, the wicked rule over the righteous, because they're willing to sell their conscience. They don't have, therefore, that's the fear of the Lord. If you have a conscience that you value, you understand the purpose of it, it helps guide you. If you get off track, you get back on the track, right? To right thinking. To say, I want to be holy. I want to be righteous and pure in your sight, God. And by extension, man, I care about my reputation. I care about my soul, where I'm going from here. I care about the conscience, because it afflicts me when I feel compunction and guilt and shame. All these funky feelings I don't want to have. So we need God to guide us. We need his help. And if we welcome him in, welcome Jesus, the teachings of Jesus, the spirit thereof, and the Holy Spirit. He said, I didn't leave you alone. But, you know, we embrace the teachings of Christ, you know, little things that are so important, like whatsoever we do or fail to do for the least of men, we do or fail to do for him. In a nutshell, to paraphrase what Jesus taught. It's really simple to understand. Children can understand the teachings of Christ, and they'll help keep us on track and have the right values. But you see why mean people, ruthless people that don't value soul, I don't know what they're thinking. I mean, what do they think? They're not going to exist anymore just because their body dies, that they are a body and that's it. So the prima facie, they think everybody else is stupid, and that, you know, we all need to be like these New World Order guys that will murder anybody to stay in power, and that we should all jump on their bandwagon, I mean, of insanity and madness and craven, murderous, freaking... I mean, there's not enough adjectives in the world to describe how heinous their behavior is. And through history, it's that same element, that same caliber, mentality of people that are running the show. And God is not going to tolerate